Many small and fragile countries are highly exposed and vulnerable to the adverse effects of climate change. And for some small island economies, the threat is existential. This means that adapting to climate change, that is, building resilient infrastructure and preparing for the future, is critical. But often, these countries lack the means to finance much-needed climate adaptation initiatives. That's why we must improve access to climate finance for small and fragile countries that are climate exposed. And we must act now. My name is Natalija Novta.
And I'm Gemma Preston. In this presentation, based on IMF staff research, we will examine the successes and challenges faced by countries in accessing climate finance, draw lessons from the experience of small and fragile countries in the Pacific region, and identify new ways for the international community to work together to improve access to major sources of finance, like the Green Climate Fund.
First, let's consider what climate change looks like in the Pacific Islands. By the end of this century, average annual temperatures in the region could rise up to 3.7 degrees Celsius. More frequent and intense storms will continue to cause widespread coastal flooding and shoreline erosion. Sea levels could increase by up to 2 meters. For some countries, this is greater than their highest point above sea level.
That's significant, Natalija. Fortunately, there are well-known ways to climate-proof infrastructure. But the costs are very large, and in many countries, debt levels are already high and rising.
That's right. The average investment needs for climate-proofing infrastructure are estimated between 6 and 9% of GDP annually for Pacific Island countries, or almost $1 billion each and every year for the next 10 years. Sustained investment on this scale for 10 years or more will be impossible without a mix of grants and concessional loans, especially given the deterioration of fiscal positions due to COVID-19.
Thankfully, some climate finance has already been allocated to the Pacific. About $3.3 billion has been approved for climate projects over the 6 years from 2014 to 2019. Now, this includes everything from bilateral and multilateral sources and for adaptation and mitigation projects. So this might sound good, but remember, the estimated adaptation needs alone are almost $1 billion each and every year. So that leaves big gaps between the needs, the approvals, and the actual disbursements.
For example, if we look at the Green Climate Fund, the most dominant global climate fund since it started approving projects in 2015, total approvals for the Pacific Islands over the 6 years are only about half of the estimated annual needs. And the total disbursements, that is money actually hitting the ground, are only around a quarter of the annual adaptation needs.
So why has it been so challenging for Pacific Island countries to access climate funds? Well, a lot depends on the approach that countries take. Many countries want to access finance from a climate fund directly because it gives them control and ownership over their projects. But this direct approach requires getting accredited. Achieving this accreditation is challenging because there are many requirements you need to meet. This includes having robust public financial management, as well as developing gender policies and setting environmental and social standards. Some of these need to be prepared from scratch and require institution building. So there's a lot to do.
Indeed. Part of the challenge is the volume and intensity of the requirements. The other part is that it requires a big investment of time and resources by countries where capacity is already very thin. Accreditation, on average, is taking between 2 to 5 years for Pacific Island countries, and reaccreditation is required every 5 years. Moreover, being accredited doesn't automatically unlock any finance. It then takes longer for specific projects to be approved and dollars to flow. And those later stages also require additional expertise in public investment management.
So, are there any options for countries to access climate funds? Well, yes. Countries can partner with an international accredited entity like the World Bank or the UNDP. For the Pacific, this has so far been the most fruitful option, at least in terms of the number of projects, their size, and the speed of access to funds. Now, these partnerships can work really well when there's good alignment between what the country wants and what international partner priorities are. But demand for support from international partners is high, so unfortunately, not all requests can be supported.
Before exploring solutions, let's take stock of where we are now. First, it is clear that without grants and concessional loans, it will be extremely challenging to meet the cost of climate adaptation. And this concerns not only the Pacific Islands, but all small and fragile states.
Second, partnering with international entities to access major climate funds can provide a fruitful pathway to financing. And third, direct access to climate funds requires robust public financial management tools. But the standards are complex, and achieving them takes time, which is increasingly out of step with the pace needed to adapt to climate challenges.
This all sounds quite daunting, but the good news is that there is a lot that we can do. Here are some of the things that countries, climate funds, and the IMF could do to meet this challenge head on. Countries should take a strategic view of how best to match climate project proposals with potential funding sources and delivery partners. This can involve determining which projects may be better financed through bilateral channels compared to those that should be pursued through climate funds.
Where resource constraints allow, one good idea is establishing dedicated climate units. These units preferably sit within ministries of finance to ensure that adaptation project proposals are integrated into countries' national infrastructure and climate adaptation plans. Finally, countries should continue to build public financial management capacity. Strong audit, robust controls frameworks, and strengthened public investment management practices are the priorities.
And what about climate funds? Climate funds should consider further streamlining accreditation requirements for small and fragile countries and prioritizing requirements in areas where stronger public financial management capacity will significantly strengthen financial safeguards. They should also consider increasing reliance on ex post monitoring and reporting.
And for its part, the IMF will enhance integration of climate issues into macroeconomic surveillance in line with the IMF's climate strategy and provide capacity development support to countries to build stronger public financial management, to meet requirements, and share lessons learned among countries.
And as an institution, we can use our convening power to bring stakeholders together and facilitate discussions on optimizing climate adaptation finance in international fora.
After all, we're all in this together.